Hi, everyone. Welcome back. It's my great honor to introduce our next speaker. Please say a warm welcome to Anastasia.
Hello, everyone. Today, I will talk about how, with a dash of creativity and do-it-yourself attitude, you can test anything in any industry without breaking the bank. So I have lined up the 5 independent stories about how could you improve the software and hardware testing based on my experience in trucking industry. So let me introduce myself. My name is Anastasia Engelhardt. I'm a QA specialist at Launch Control. Also, I'm a proud ambassador of Google Women TechMakers community. We create content and organize meetups to involve more women in IT. Also, I have an IT blog, GenoIT, on Instagram. So before I delve into the first story, I want to share some insights about the trucking industry, so making sure we are on the same page. So the trucking industry revolves itself as an economic powerhouse that contributes about $30 million to the economy and providing jobs for 7 million individuals. Also, it's not about just the transportation of goods, it's also a source of a tax revenue. So let me explain the trucking software in just 60 seconds. So you have the dispatchers who is using the web application to make routes and share the instruction to the drivers who used a mobile application. So here's the 2 essential things about trucking. So the drivers must pay attention to the hours of service. That's the regulations that governs the working hours of the truck drivers. So for instance, driver can drive up to 11 hours, but should rest at least 30 minutes after every 8 hours of driving. And also record of duty status. So drivers should track all their activities like driving, sleeping, resting, and even using the truck for their personal reasons. So how does the dispatchers should know whether the driver clicks on driving status or actually driving? So we use ELD devices that are connected to the truck and also connected to the mobile application. This serves us as a compliance watchdogs because they record both drivers and truck activity from engine statistics to shifts. So now you know all the fundamental things about the trucking industry. So let me move on the first story. So we all were children once, and you know, kids have wild imagination. They sit on a bench and pretending they act like the drivers, the driver bus, car. But when we became an adult, we think more rationally, practical. And in this story, I will show you how, as you act like a driver, you can improve your hardware testing. So as testers, our mission revolves to test the compatibility between ELD devices and the mobile phones. To ensure comprehensive testing, we use a powerful but simply technique known as the decision table. So a decision table is a visual tool that lays out different conditions and their corresponding outcomes in a format of the table. So here we have, for our case, ELD devices power status, mobile phone power status, distance between them, and connection. The decision table could be really helpful for creating unit tests, for creating cases for unit tests as well. So when we created the decision table, we tested our connection in the office. It was really good, but Then we had a problem with a case for lost connection. We tried in the office, we tried outside, but we would lost the signal. So until our colleague went to the basement floor in our office, brewed the coffee, and then the notification appears, bad connection. So now the developers go to the kitchen and saw the QA, we had a tricky response, I'm testing the connection right now. We have succeeded in our testing, but we need more challenges. So we decided to put our testing on the streets, quite literally. So imagine, you have two testers, one is a driver and one is a co-driver. Co-driver adjusts statuses and plug the ELD event on the car. Why did we do that? We want to test all the various drivers and vehicle statuses cases in real-world scenarios. So we have once a bizarre production issue when we have an unplugged event during the driving. What is an unplugged event? So literally, the driver should unplug the ELD from the car's hood and then resume driving. So if you pause and think about it, it is impossible. But we tried to reproduce this case. So we went to the countryside, driving, then accidentally stopped, unplugged our ELD device, and continued to driving. And we really reproduced this case because we find out that application thinks that maybe we actually stopped because of a traffic jam, because we don't power off our engine. And it was really good, but we have an unexpected situation. So the Serbian police pull us over because the co-driver doesn't put on the seatbelt. And the most hilarious thing is that we have a feature called roadside inspection. And if you in the USA, if the police pull you over and stops, you just click the button to have a roadside inspection and just give your phone to the policeman. So testing the real world case in Serbia, actually we had tested the most unrealistic case. So let me unpack the lessons for you. So decision tables are your best friend that will cover all your requirements. It could be helpful for developers when you implement some new feature and you should create some basic cases. Also, our experience with the unplugged scenario taught us a valuable lessons. Always consider even the most unlikely situation before they going to the production. And if the office environment doesn't fit you with the testing, don't hesitate to step into the real world of testing. So the next story is relating to testing mobile application. We use both mobile application, Android and iOS, and also used an Android studio. But why is it so essential to use real devices? Before I talk about real devices, I want to share you some tips about the Android Studio. So as you know, we have simulated driving in Serbia, but we can't simulate driving using American maps. We had a feature called near gas station. So you should enable your location and then you receive a notification about the nearest gas station. We used VPN first, but it was not so practical because we didn't have the exact address. So we find out that you could have, you should put and copy the coordinates to Android Studio, and that's it. Here's a simple step. So you just go on the Google Map, search for address, open the emulator, and important tip, always enable location, then click on location, choose custom location, and enter coordinates, and that's it. So it will be helpful for such application as taxi application or the application for delivering food. So, why does we opt out for real testing? It's all about ensuring that critical functionality, especially when it involves activities like driving, works seamlessly. Also, our drivers has a variety of hardware, so every phone has its unique hardware specs and networking conditions. So why should we invest in mobile farm? First, we were testing on our personal devices. It was really good for basic cases. But then we had cases like putting your mobile phone to be in a driver status up to 10 hours. So it's really not so practical. Then we decided to use a mobile farm. So first, if you want to have a mobile farm, you should research what operating system and phone models are the most popular among your users. Next, you can browse the online marketplace. We use Coupon Pro Dem and acquire the devices. So what was the result? We decreased the production bugs related to different operating systems. Now, let me dive into a particular challenge we have. So we have a driver who has a really old Android phone with a version of KitKat. He was a really old customer, and we appreciate it. But he had once a major problem. He reported to us, and no matter how hard we tried to reproduce it, we can't. Why does it happen? Because he has this rare phone that was even, it hasn't been officially available in Serbia. So once again, we go to Coupon Pro Dem and send one message to the user who was living abroad, and after 2 months, he bought us a phone on a German market. But we can make it easier. Recently, I came across a fantastic tool called Browser Stack. So you could use it for manual testing remotely on remote devices, such as laptops, phone models, or tablets. So if you had some bugs on a specific model of phone, laptop, or a tablet, just use the browser tag. It is really easy. So one more important tip for those who are not in the testing world, the testers came across regression testing. So we have test cases, and we used to check whether the expected result is the same. It is really exhausting when you read these 30 to 40 test cases every day. And here's some interesting statistics about you and me. The studies suggest that about 65% of people are visual learners. So how could you implement that into your project? It is really simple. Just add a screenshot and more picture in your documentation. So when we tested the notification for the mobile, we just put in the expected result and screenshot, and as a result, we have speed up the testing processes by 37%. It's really easy and it's really helpful. So what tips can you apply today? If your users had a variety of operating system and phone models, just use a mobile farm. Also, if you had a problem with a specific phone model, just join to a browser stack. And of course, remember to use visuals. So the next story is about how we tested the AI camera, how we are acting like a Thai drivers, how we are acting like a drug drivers, and why it is important to have an informal meetings with the developers. So we had a dash camera Dash cameras is a camera with AI capabilities. So what sets dash cams apart? So first, protection against fraudulent claims. You make sure you're not a victim. The second, the thief deterrence. So it's all about the psychology. You know, thieves avoid being on cameras, and you're adding one more layer of protection. Of course, here is they provide reassurance. Why? Because if you have an unexpected event, you will be always recorded and have a recorded evidence. And one more thing is detect destruction. With AI capabilities, it could also track the driver's behavior. So when we started to testing an AI camera, we have many challenges. First, only American SIM card work with it. When we solve it, we have plenty of work. We worked both on live video streaming and on-demand records. And as we're working together with the developers in the office, we have many informal meetings. Why informal, you ask? It happens because we don't want to focus on meetings, like you have 2, 3, 5, 4 meetings just because of meetings. So we decided to focus on developing a useful and faster application as demands a QA team. And on the other side, developers should really be able to implement the ideas. So we find the optimal solutions and had the informal meetings in the office. And then we used a really simple technique approach called the 5 Whys method. So why the 5 Whys method? First, you state a problem, like we had that problem. And then you repeat, why does it happen? Why does it happen? The more answers, that better. But your answers should be based on the facts. So here's one tip. You could use the reverse logic and answer to the why question. It helps us to develop and coding faster using this approach. So when we fixed all the problems, the really interesting game begin. So in AI cameras, as I said, detecting the driver's behavior. And then we want to use and test the AI alarms, such as smoke alarms, alarms preventing thieves, and then our QA team acts like a driver. So funny story time, we had a colleague that was non-smoker, and he was pretending that he was smoking a cigarette in the office for about 1 hour to trigger the alarm. But he failed, and the hilarious thing that the next day, our smoker colleague, who has accidentally an AI camera in his car, just lit the cigarette, and that's it. We have a notification of the alarm. So, from that moment, we knew that we should test only in the car. And then we go to test on the streets again, and we had really interesting situations. So, all our testers really deserve an Oscar. Some of them were yawning for about 50 times to trigger the alarm. Some of them acting like they have an influence of the alcohols, or they were drugs to take and test the system. So using our acting skills, aim to understand the system capabilities better and ensuring it had detect hazardous conditions on the road. So here's a tip. If you want to test your system, sometimes you should act like a user going mad. So here's the first story. It's about the magic time when you have 25 hours a day, and that extra day actually not just so helpful in the trucking industry. We are talking about the daylight saving time, both in Serbia and in the USA. We change our time to go 1 hour beyond or above. So we have the 25 or 23 hours a year. So as I said before, you know that in the trucking industry, the time is crucial and every second matters. So if you go beyond some times, you must have a penalties. So what did we do to solve this problem? We use our time machine. No, not the scientific one. First, we used our server and was changing the time on server to test on the DST day, on the day before the DST, and the day after the DST. We had about 120 cases that we checked manually. Why not automated scripts, you ask? Actually, we had an automated script, but the expected result was for a normal day, that is a 24 hours. So it was really good, but we have plenty of cases that requires a specific time, and we use really many, many hours to test it. So here's a Docker to rescue. We use a Docker to test on the localhost application and using Android Studio. So make sure that every QA member can adjust the time he needs on his computer. And here's one tip. Also, we speed up the testing about for 48%. And here's the tip. Don't use Windows for the Docker and the time machine. Because every time you change the time on the Windows, you should reset it. So it's really exhausted. It's better to use Linux or Mac. So the best thing, and what I suggest you, to put the DST case in your testing. Whether you're a developer or a tester, just put these two cases for 23 or 25 hours, especially as your users are in the country that has a DST. And the last story is about organizing the development and the QA team. How could you decrease the time of running automated scripts, and how standardized documentation could help you to speed up the release process? So when I worked as a QA in the trucking industry, we have done many manual checks, and we hadn't time for writing automated test cases. So after 3 months I worked as QA, our team leader wants to divide our QA team to an automation team and the manual team. I was an automation team, and we really had a lot of work. We should test it and cover all the features we have to make sure we will speed up the regression. So what was the result of dividing two teams? First, we covered almost all cases with 5,000 tests after 6 months. We would do a really great job, and that, because of this test, we have releases every 2 or 3 weeks. So we have only 1 day for debugging and regression testing, unlike 2 or 1 week of the regression testing when we have one QA team. So what superpower allows us to write test scripts that fast? Our automation framework was based on Selenium and Lioneight and Java. We used a page object model to divide methods and tests. As the most important and useful things, we use XPaaS, but not with an ID or names, but which one that related to HTML elements. Why? Because HTML elements doesn't change so often. And we use also arguments, so we have reusable Heapspaces that we could have in such in every test we have. So when we speak about reusability, I had an idea to standardize the documentation. So in our application, web application, we have snack bars, error messages, and text titles for the dialogues. It was really exhausting to put all these labels into our test project. So I decided to standardize it by simply making a document that will help the developers not to think what text I should put in this error message, but we simplify and unify all the text. So after we prepared this document, the QA automation team could create test cases even before the developers start coding. And after we wrote this standardized documentation, we used the shift left approach. So as we know, we have two decided teams. One was a QA manual team, and one was the automation team. So both one member of the manual team and one member of the automation team was analyze the document. It can be requirements, or it can be the technical specification before the developer starts coding. So the result was that we reduced bugs based on the features about an 80%. As I said, we have covered almost all features, and it was really great. But then we have one more problem. We had too much data. We have about 7,000 tests, and in each test, we call the app request to create companies with drivers, vehicles, and sometimes with different vehicles and vehicle status. So our server struggled for about, if we have 7,000 tests, so our solution was to create a Jenkins script that will clean up all the data after every 1,000 company is created. It is really helpful. We have a test of some plugin in the Jenkins who has saved all the results of our testing, but Jenkins had cleared up all the data. So here's the tips to implement. I really suggest you to analyze your specification before coding and have a small meeting with a QA. So standardizing the documents make you to achieve a more unified application, and also writing automated scripts to speed up your regression. So we've taken a deep dive into the world of trucks and mobile testing. Dash cams and automated testing represents our commitment to innovation and progress. Challenges like daylight saving time exist, but we adapt and find solutions. So this journey was about blending transport with technology and highlighting the power of teamwork. Together, we continue to pave the way forward. Thank you very much. Do we have any questions?
Hi. How do you handle human mistakes in trucking industry?
So one of the human mistakes, as you can see, it was the unplugged event. So drivers used to unplug the ELD devices so the dispatchers can't locate them. So we use these production issues and testing in real case scenarios. So if you're talking about the human mistake, most of all, we based our cases, we speak to drivers, we speak to the technical support, find these cases and use these cases to test it in the real world scenarios with an AI camera.
Great, thanks. And the second question, how do you, I'm guessing you're using some kind of hardware. to do some automatic tests?
Actually, we use only ELD device and AI camera that is plugged and connected to the car and to the mobile application. No hardware.
Oh, okay.
Additional, okay. I mean.
Okay, great. Thanks.
No more questions? Okay, then that's it. Thank you for a great talk. We'll take a short break and we'll be back with this and the other stage. Thank you.